with you.
And also with you.
My name is Katie Graves, and I'm one of the members here. It's my honor to welcome each and every one of you to Mayfield First. We're so glad that you've joined us this morning. Do me a favor and grab a bulletin. There are lots of announcements in there. Some of them are opportunities to serve and participate. Some of them are for you, and some of them are for the folks sitting near you. I do want to point out, I don't know if it made it into the bulletin or not, but next Sunday, after the morning worship, June the 2nd, everyone is invited to Trinity for a fundraiser for the Jamaican Mission Team. There's no set cost, it's donations only. It's fish, fries, hush puppies, slaw, white beans, and desserts. So you can go out there, pick up your meal, make a donation to the Jamaican Mission Team, and that'll be next Sunday, June the 2nd. Okay? Please pray for all of these things in the coming week. There's also a tear-off form on the bulletin. You can let us know here. Know that you're here this morning, and if you have any prayer requests, you can submit those there. As you pray on this Memorial Day weekend, please be sure to remember those who died while serving our country. We're so glad you chose to join us for worship this morning. Let's begin with a prayer. The words are on the screen so that we can all pray together. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Acts 16:9-15, and I was the lucky one that got this scripture reading because there's lots of cities in here that are difficult to pronounce, but honoring Jennifer Walker, I'm going to read them, and if I'm wrong, I'm going to read them wrong confidently. Okay. With my West Kentucky accent on top of that. Okay. That night, Paul had a dream. A Macedonian stood on the far shore and called across the sea, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." The dream gave Paul his map. We went to work, at once getting things ready to cross over to Macedonia. All the pieces had come together. We knew now for sure that God had called us to preach the good news to the Europeans. Putting out from the harbor of Troas, we made a straight run for Samothrace. It's close. The next day, we tied up at New City and walked from there to Philippi, the main city in that part of Macedonia. And even more importantly, a Roman colony. We lingered there several days. On the Sabbath, we left the city and went down along the river where we had heard there was to be a prayer meeting. We took our place with the women who had gathered there and talked with them. One woman, Lydia, was from Thyatira and a dealer in expensive tiles, known to be a God-fearing woman. As she listened with intensity to what was being said, the Master gave her a trusting heart, and she believed. After she was baptized, along with everyone in her household, she said in a surge of hospitality, "If you're confident that I'm in this with you and believe in the Master truly, come home with me and be my guest." We hesitated, but she wouldn't take no for an answer. Please join me in the affirmation of faith. Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions. comes from Psalm 67. Your part will be in bold. O God, be gracious to us and bless us, and make your face to shine upon us.
That your way may be known upon earth, your saving power among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us.
God has blessed us. Our scripture reading today comes from Revelation 21, 9 through 12, and 21, 22 through 22, 5. One of the seven angels who had carried the bowls filled with the seven final disasters spoke to me. Come here, I'll show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. He took me away in the spirit to an enormous high mountain and showed me holy Jerusalem descending out of heaven from God, resplendent in the bright glory of God. The main street of the city was pure gold, translucent as glass, but there was no sign of a temple, for the Lord God, the Sovereign Strong, and the Lamb are the temple. The city doesn't need sun or moon for light. God's glory is its light. The Lamb its lamp. The nations will walk in its light, and earth's kings bring in their splendor. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there won't be any night. They'll bring the glory and honor of the nations into the city. Nothing dirty or defiled will get into the city, and no one who defiles or deceives. Only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life will get in. Then the angel showed me Water of Life River, crystal bright. It flowed from the throne of God and the Lamb, right down the middle of the street. The tree of life was planted on each side of the river, producing 12 kinds of fruit, a ripe fruit each month. The leaves of the tree are for healing the nations. Never again will anything be cursed. The throne of God and of the Lamb is at the center. His servants will offer God service, worshiping. They'll look on his face, their foreheads mirroring God. Never again will there be any night. No one will need lamplight or sunlight. The shining of God, the Master, is all the light anyone needs. And they will rule with him age after age after age.
And these ones we give back to God that which God has given to us. If you are visiting with us and have an offering to make, we welcome that offering. But if you're part of another congregation and you made your tithe covenant here, then you want to take that back. You've heard me tell you, I'm going away and I'm coming back. If you loved me, you would be glad that I'm on the way to the Father, because the Father is the goal and purpose of my life. I've told you this ahead of time, before it happens, so that when it does happen, the confirmation will deepen your belief in me. This is the word of God for you who are the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, the word that you give to us is a gift. Teach us how to understand it. Teach us how it might inform our lives. Teach us how it might change who we are and who we are in the world. We ask this for the sake of Christ. Amen. I had a whole lot of separation anxiety as a child. I passed that along to my kids in some ways, in various forms, but if my parents were going to go somewhere and I had to be babysat, we had to get the AAA version of babysitters because I was a handful. I know that's hard for some of you to imagine, but if you just close your eyes and think about it for a minute. Seriously, I had a whole lot of difficulty with the idea that my parents might leave and not come back. And I don't know where it comes from. They never left me anywhere. They never abandoned me. They never gave me cause to think that I wasn't going to be retrieved from a daycare center at some point. But I had a great deal of anxiety about that. Fast forward a few years to service in Jackson. I was working at a church down there that had a technology center, sort of like we do, but instead of being in a balcony, it was in a small room that you climbed up to. You had a ladder that you had to get up there to. And the computer up there was probably the fastest thing around. If it had handlebars, you could have driven it around the room a little bit. And that's where my son Jack used to like to go. He would work on that computer because he was programming things. He would come up with these great JavaScript programs that would do incredible and amazing things, like a version of 20 questions that got the answer right more than they got it wrong. It was amazing to watch him do some of that coding. So one afternoon, I'm finishing up work, and Jack's with me because he's finished up his homeschooling, and he's gone up to do some programming. And when I went to the car, I went straight home, and I got a text from Jack that said, "When are we leaving?" And I realized he's upstairs. He's at the church, which I just locked and turned off all the lights. And, well, he doesn't know, so I better get back up there as fast as I can. So I went and I pulled up under the awning and opened up the church and went and called up the steps and said, "We're ready to go." And he came downstairs and never was the wiser until the second time that it happened. And his text that time just said, "You left me up here again, didn't you?" I racked my brain. Who could have told him? Who could have told him? But that separation anxiety for Jack was never a big deal, not in that form. The separation anxiety that I experienced with Jack had a lot more to do with leaving him in Jackson when we came here. That was tough. I'd been preparing for the idea of him driving off to college. I wasn't ready to drive away and leave him to go to school. I think about that every time I read this passage, and I think about this passage every time I re-experience those emotions of being left, being on my own, not having anybody who could take care of me if I'm apart from. When Jesus left the disciples, he did not leave them comfortless. And neither did we leave Jack without any kind of support system. He had friends across Jackson, Tennessee. He had a whole church full of people who loved him and continue to guide and direct him and give him the things that a young man his age needs, the advice, the idea Sunday. Don't you want to go get a bird and take it into the sanctuary so you can show off parakeets on Parakeet Sunday? It's kind of funny the first 15 times or so. The idea of a paraclete, though, is completely different than a little bird in a cage. It's an uncaged bird. It's a bird whose song inspires us. It's a bird that takes us on a journey if we follow after where it's flying to. And the Holy Spirit is designed to do just that, to give us the same sort of leadership and guidance that Jesus once gave the disciples. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we're able to read Scripture and understand. It's one of the most important parts of this Wesleyan quadrilateral that I talk about so much. Some of you are tired of it, but I have to say to you that this is the way that all Christians do it. We just talk about these different parts and pieces and components. Because every Christian who is able to read Scripture starts with Scripture. Every Christian who is able to read Scripture must rely on what that person has been taught. So as I'm reading through the Bible, as I'm making decisions as a pastor, as I'm making decisions as a father and a husband, I'm remembering what my parents taught me. I'm remembering lessons that I've given to my son and my daughter. And I'm remembering things that I've given to congregations across West Tennessee and Western Kentucky. And those lessons, the ones that I've given, the ones that I've received, the ones that I've heard from other pastors, from bishops, those things inform what I'm doing. It helps to make plain what's happening in Scripture. Because I wouldn't have known the difference between a parakeet and a paraclete if somebody hadn't told me. We get to the most important aspect of reading Scripture, and that's trusting in the Holy Spirit to bring understanding to each of us. Whether that happens in a moment like worship, a high holy moment where we sit before God, we stand before God, we praise God, we sing our songs to God, we offer prayer to God. Or whether it's a moment when we're out in the woods hiking, or out on the golf course, or maybe at the swimming pool where many of our colleagues and patriots are today. Maybe they're having an experience of the Holy Spirit where they are as well. But no matter how many times I hear someone say, when I'm out on my bike, or when I'm out in the woods, or when I'm hiking or swimming, or I look at that waterfall, I'm having an experience of the Holy Spirit, I say, that's great. But make sure that you also make room for an experience of the Holy Spirit when you're reading this book. It's vital. As the Word of God, it brings to us the things that God gave to our forebears, that we might know them. As the Word of God, it gives us an understanding of the structure of God's plan for us, the logos, the things that make sense, the logic of what it is that God's asking us to do, and the new logic that says power is not important, it's powerlessness. It's watching Jesus as he walks to the Via Dolorosa. It's watching Jesus as he's nailed to the cross. That's not a symbol of power, my friends. It only becomes a symbol of power in the resurrection. But in that powerlessness, an empire began to crumble. Because power stopped being quite so important that day. How do we know this? From reading the Scriptures. From seeing what happened as other people had their experience of the Holy Spirit and wrote letters to one another. Whether it was James, the brother of Jesus, or Paul, or people who wrote just like Paul did, it doesn't matter, because in their writing, they helped us to understand and interpret what happened in that moment on the cross. Scripture, tradition, and experience of the Holy Spirit, and then our own ability to reason through what it is we read. That was a no-brainer, folks. If we're not able to understand how the noun goes with the verb, we're not going to understand what it is that we're reading, because it won't make any sense. This is how all Christians do it. So in the importance of this day, where we're reading Scripture that tells us, I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm not going to leave you without guidance. I'm not going to leave you without power. We have the Word of God telling us what that power is going to be. That power is the Holy Spirit. It helps us to make plain what it is that Jesus was trying to say to us. I've often lamented that Jesus left and didn't stick around to teach and lead and guide us. I've often thought, I wish I could sit down with Jesus. We were talking in Sunday school just this morning, coffee with Jesus. How cool would that be? Just to sit down and ask a few questions and get much better answers than you'll asking God to give me fresh eyes so that I can see what's on the page. For others, it's an entire weekend away. For still others, it might be a combination of those things. Take the Bible and find your favorite place to sit. Go to your favorite happy place out in the woods. Sit under a tree. It may be a tire swing. It was for me for a little while. Sit and read and let God speak. Opening ourselves up to the Holy Spirit is the primary way in which we are able to make plain what it is that God is trying to say to us. Because as important as any written material is, it's that interaction on a personal basis with God that makes all the difference. One thing I want to add to the sermon today is something that came up in Sunday school as well, and that's the idea that when you're having that conversation with the Holy Spirit, it's a different kind of conversation you might have if you're imagining that coffee with Jesus. It's a different kind of conversation that you might have than you might have if you were having a conversation with the Creator God of the universe. Say you're out walking and hiking, you see the things of nature, and you realize the majesty of God's creation, and it speaks to the intelligence of the one who designed it. That's a different relationship than the Holy Spirit, who sometimes comes in ways that are difficult to put our thumbs on, and very different from the ways that we imagine conversations with Jesus to be like, based on what we've read from Scripture. In all of these modes and methods of interacting with the deity, we have ways to understand, as much as the human mind can understand, what it is that God's trying to do for us, what God is trying to do with us, what God is trying to do through us. But to make it plain, it is the power of the Holy Spirit, because Jesus himself promises that in this passage of Scripture that was read in your hearing that we read together. So when you read the Bible, don't just open it up and go from point A to point B and say, got it done. That's all I have to do for today. Dwell in that place. Let God's Holy Spirit wash over you and speak in ways that go beyond words. Change your heart, to open your mind, to broaden your perceptions, and to set you on a path that will lead you not necessarily to glory for your sake, but for the glory of Jesus Christ and the elevation of the church. So that in all things, God might be raised up high, and all our neighbors then might see what it is that we found and come to know that same saving relationship with Jesus that we have, that they might come to know that same comforting relationship with the Holy Spirit that we're talking about today, and ultimately that they might bow the knee before Almighty God, their Creator and ours. Let us pray. Jesus, we were worried when you left that we wouldn't be able to understand how to proceed. And your followers throughout the ages have made the same lamentation as do we. Remind us that your Holy Spirit is with us, that we have the presence of the Comforter, and that in all things, God, we might be able to see who you are most clearly simply by resting in your presence. Allow that to take place today. For the sake of Christ, through the Holy Spirit, worshiping one God now and forevermore. Amen. If you have sought that relationship with Jesus, and you felt the prompting and urging of the Holy Spirit, and now you feel like you're ready to make that commitment, I encourage you to do that today. If you need to do that in a place that's a little more intimate, without so many people looking, we do that at Coffee with the Pastor on Second Sundays, and we'd love to have you for that. If you're a part of another congregation and you want to be in this congregation, or you've made a decision as a disciple in the past and now you're ready to give even more over to God, same thing applies. If you'd like to make those commitments, meet me right here or see me on Second Sundays in the Sunday school class on this side of the church. No matter what you do, open yourself to the Holy Spirit, especially on this day. So that as we are recognizing the promise that Jesus made to us about the coming of the Holy Spirit, we can fully live into that moment of receiving the Holy Spirit, confirming what it is that Jesus taught. If you need to come and have that talk with the Holy Spirit here as we sing our final song for the day, know that there is place and room for you. No matter what you do, give God honor and glory as we prepare to go into the world in mission and ministry. words aloud as a benediction to one another and practice for what we might say to those